Welcome to the Thorpdale district. This is Sean Durkin's farm, about 6 kilometres from the spud shed. Sean's business is growing food. He is a professional farmer, an expert in his field. Of all the things we do in this community, the growth of good food is one of the most important. Literally everything else we do depends upon it. One of Sean's chosen crops is potatoes. In Australia, potatoes are a staple food, a commodity for which demand is never ending. The average Australian family of five will eat over 300 kilos a year, and that's only those that are sold on the fresh food market, never mind things like potato chips or frozen foods. This film is the story of how good food is planted. In this case, one of our most important, potatoes. About 60% of all harvested potatoes in Australia are processed into fast foods. Of what remains, 10% is used as seed, and the rest is traded on the fresh food market. Producers around the Thorpdale area grow around 70,000 tonnes a year, and harvest most of it between February and March. But before you can grow a potato, you need the seed. Seed potatoes are some of last year's crop retained for planting, and are stored between harvests in a large cool room.
So it's basically just controlled atmosphere. So this is there. These are the other ones that haven't been pulled out. Now he's been pulling them out for about a week. Those ones out there were pulled out last Thursday night. So they leave them out a week so that they warm up. But in here it's 4 degrees Celsius, so it's basically just so that just stops them all from shooting.
All potato producers these days use seed that is certified. These are spuds that are disease-free and are grown and harvested from ground that has been largely free of plant viruses for at least 5 years. A paddock, which is lain fallow for such a period, is known as new ground. Now these are the spuds that were taken out last Thursday. As they warm up, the spuds start to shoot and become ready for planting. You've probably seen potatoes like this before, perhaps after you've left them in the pantry for too long. But that's where the similarity ends. As we've seen, Sean's potatoes have been stored in specially controlled conditions to ensure they remain virus-free. The ones in your cupboard, well, no offence, but who knows? As we all know, potatoes are tubers, or edible roots, and have multiple buds or eyes. Each individual potato will develop many shoots, which means if you divide them into thirds or even quarters for the bigger potatoes, you will end up with several plants from just one tuber. I reckon you could probably cut this one into at least 6 pieces. It's huge! This here is a cutter, and it will sort and cut the tubers into just the right size for planting. As the seeds are moved through by the conveyor belt, the immature shoots are rolled off. But don't worry, they do grow back. The smaller potatoes are cut into 3 pieces, the larger ones into quarters. To protect the cut potatoes, a coating is applied. The coating is called bark flour, or more specifically, fir bark flour. It is what it sounds like, literally pulverised tree bark. The bark contains a natural antifungal ingredient, which allows the exposed flesh of the cut potato to heal in the ground and prevent infection by disease. Being organic, bark flour is non-persistent, and its effects are limited to only the first couple of weeks of growing. After that, anything left is simply absorbed into the soil. The final quality of Sean's crop will determine what his customers will pay, as potatoes are bound for the fresh food market, so each of the tubers he grows must be of the highest quality possible. The coated cut spuds are collected into massive bags ready for transport out to the paddocks. Each bag will hold several thousand tubers ready for planting, which amounts to nearly a tonne. The average paddock will require 5 to 10 bags before planting is completed.
Where you left your car?
Yep.
Looks like this bag, it's ready to go.
With the planter and everything to load it up, we might take half a bag down and some super.
Now, despite your best plans and always at that critical moment, something always seems to go wrong. The machine Sean and Ash are working on is a potato planter, specifically built, as you will see later, for placing the cut tubers into the ground and covering them with soil. They are trying to repair the planter, but they know they have limited time. It's forecast to rain in the next couple of days, and both of them are keen to get in as much planting as possible before that happens. So just for a moment, we might leave them here and come back later.
It's going to be hard to get to.
There's a reason why we call it Mother Earth. Everything that sustains us comes from the soil. The soils around most of Thorpdale are volcanic in origin, but as far as I can work out, there hasn't been an eruption around here for a couple of million years, so your average paddock is covered in topsoil that's very old. The soil is red due to the oxidising of iron compounds in the ground. It's rusting. It drains very well but needs nutrients and organic matter to retain good structure. So what makes a good soil? Let's go back to school, just for a moment. Soil is composed of four ingredients: mineral particles of varying different sizes and of various origins, organic matter, dead plant and animal material, water, the key ingredient, and air, nitrogen being a very important element. Mineral particles in soils are defined by their size, and depending on their size are described as sand, the largest particle, silt, the next largest, and clay, the smallest. It's a mixture of these three particles that gives soil its texture. Organic matter is any matter that was once living, and next to water is the lifeblood of all types of soils. This is one way soil is able to store nutrients and hold on to moisture and air. A soil without organic matter is starving. Typically, a moist, free-draining soil will hold 25 to 35% water by volume, and another 15 to 25% of that volume will just be air. Water and air is held in micropores, or the tiny spaces in the soil, and both these elements feed the microorganisms that plants, such as potatoes, depend upon. Now, about 3% of most matter present in healthy soil is some kind of organism. Bacteria, fungi, mites, ants, worms, beetles, slugs, snails, the list goes on. They live on organic matter, and as they break down this material, they release oxygen and mineral nutrients. They improve soil structure by burrowing and digging, creating more micropores. And then there's soil pH, which is a measure of acidity, but class dismissed. We'll get back to that later. For a farmer like Sean, care of his farm is a serious scientific business. And because he is in this industry for the long haul, he has to take pretty good care of his land. Some weeks ago, this paddock was chisel ploughed, and all the organic matter, mostly grass, was turned over into the soil. As you can see, what remains after this initial rough chisel ploughing are large, lumpy, rock-like aggregates of soil. these aggregates have to be broken down even further, and the organic material within the soil distributed as evenly as possible to create the right conditions for planting. This tractor is breaking down those large lumps, raking the ground and aerating the soil. It's not the world's most interesting job, but it has to be done, nonetheless. Incidentally, I wonder how that repair is going. Prepared, ready to go. Distance and isolation makes farmers reasonably self-reliant, which gives them a cross-section of skills not many of us have. What you are looking at here is a two-row potato planter, which inserts the seed into the ground as well as distributing the correct amount of fertiliser into the row. With a machine like this, Sean can plant acres and acres of spuds in a single day. Preparing the planter for use is a matter of loading up the seed and the fertiliser. About the same time as Sean chisel ploughed the paddock, he had his soil tested for pH and levels of NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. From that test, a correct batch of fertiliser is made up specific to the needs of the crop and the paddock. Not too much and not too little. The planter bins are filled by releasing a tag on the bottom of each bag, which opens a small hole. The bags weigh over a ton, and a large tractor equipped with a forklift is needed to move them. A counterweight has to be bolted to the back of the tractor to prevent it from tipping over. Fertiliser in one bin, potatoes in the other. The planter is pulled by a small, fully tracked vehicle, which has a smaller diesel engine than a normal wheel tractor and weighs considerably less. The ground is therefore less compacted by its passing. Now, just at the back of the planter, you can see two large steel discs. There's another two on the front, only smaller. These discs are lowered into the ground just before the planter takes off down the paddock. The discs are attached to prevent the planter from sliding across the paddock, especially where the ground is steep. It's important that the planted rows remain straight. It helps in controlling weeds and maintaining the quality of the crop. They were invented and fitted by a local engineer, Frank Sheener. Over the years, Frank has been responsible for more than just a few agricultural innovations, making the tasks of planting and harvesting more efficient and much safer. The planter's job, of course, is to dig a couple of rows, drop in the seed, add a little bit of water and fertiliser, and then cover it all up again. Later on, more soil will be heaped onto the rows as the plants develop, to protect the tubers from sunlight. For every tonne of seed Sean plants, he will harvest anywhere between 18 and 22 tonnes of fully grown potatoes, depending on conditions. Dry early, rain later are the ideal conditions for growing. It will take most of the day for this particular paddock to be finished. After that, well, just for the moment, all that remains to be done is to hurry up and wait.
Oh,
there is one disease that every farmer worries about, it's potato blight. The blight will very quickly make whole crops worthless, given the right soil and temperature conditions. It will persist in the tubers even after harvesting, turning them black, reducing them to a spongy mess. Even if your paddock is free of the disease, it's borne on the wind, so no one is risk-free. But given a mixture of copper sulphate, hydrated lime, water, and the use of a local crop duster, outbreaks can be prevented. Well, that's it really. That's how good food is planted. Everybody does something a little bit different to his neighbour, but by and large, that's how thousands of farmers all around Australia grow potatoes. Still, we like to think of Thorpdale as unique. Just the right climate, fantastic soils, and a hard-working community. Well, worth a visit, really. After all that effort, silly bugger, sprayed the wrong paddock.